If you don't have spiritual intensity in your life, you don't have anything. Don't have anything. So that's why we're bringing this here as much as possible. Spiritual intensity. Experience spiritual intensity. This is what this existence, what we are here, what we need to do, what we have to do actually eventually, is go through this ordeal of spiritual intensity and gradually get used to it, get used to it, get used to it. Move our comfort zone bit by bit by bit. Evaporate the continuity fear. It's absolutely essential. So those who are doing it are doing it. Congratulations. And your life without spiritual intensity, it was to feel flat. Very, very flat. And what do people do? They try to compensate in all sorts of ways, right? Doesn't work. Does not work. So many have tried. And in so many ways, and they all eventually will say, you know what, doesn't work. I need the spiritual intensity. Now, you want intensity, this video will bring you intensity. Phase four, this is phase four teachings for those who are new to this. Phase four teachings are the highest teachings. I call it Christian Dzogchen, or Dzogchen Christianity, Dzogchen Christianity. Leap of faithers, we're leap of faithers. The phase four is getting you to this leap of faith. Dzogchen is this apex yoga, this Ati yoga, the very highest pinnacle of yoga. And the context that we talk about is Christianity, especially A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, which is coming very directly from Jesus. So Dzogchen Christianity here. Very powerful. Now there's four phases that we go through on the spiritual path. Remember, this world existence is an attempt, spirit's attempt to change what it is, which is futile. Okay, but we've gotten very used to this, very used to it, and therefore we're afraid to drop it. That's the problem we have. And because we've gotten so used to this belief that we're imperfect, because what we are really is perfect. We've gotten very used to this belief system that we're imperfect. So when we turn and put our attention on what we really are, we say, wow, that's too dazzling. Perfection, we can't handle it. It's called, so we have a severe continuity fear here. That's the only problem anyone has. Okay. So with that in mind, it takes, to evaporate the continuity fear, it takes, I say, four phases is what it, the way I'm looking at it. Phase one, two, three, four, we're at phase four here. Phase four is very different than the first three phases. Very different. Here, phase four, we get into this called leap of faith, this leap of faith. The first three phases, it's not possible to, in a positive manner, accept this leap of faith. We can hear it, but the fear is too much, is too much. So keep in mind that this video is a phase four video. We are talking about those who are very mature, who have gone through the first three phases, or are moving into the fourth phase, or working on the third phase and hearing a little bit of the fourth phase, okay, that kind of thing. It filters down a little bit. Phase four is getting ready for the leap of faith, and I've been working on that now and making a lot of progress, and super significant progress, actually. Now, as we all, our practice is full stop in the burn. Whereas when we start working on this leap of faith, we're going to feel some consternation, like, wow. And it's a mixture of real positive and real trepidation, kind of a mixture, because we're ready to take this leap of faith, and part of us is saying, whoa, wait a minute. That's too intense, I can't do that. And so don't struggle with it, don't analyze it. Keep in mind, this is not a spiritual path is not an academic exercise. One of the problems in the world right now is too many people have gone to college, gone through this, they spent, you know, 20 years or more. Some start in preschool and they're like 4 or 5 years old. They go through to graduate school to get out of college when they're 30 or something. Maybe they've been 20 to 25 years in an intense academic situation where you're supposed to please the teacher, you're supposed to get A's on the test, you're trying to answer questions. This has absolutely nothing to do with the spiritual path. Zero. There's no correlation at all. What problem is people think that spiritual path is just another class they're taking, or this year where they're taking this, or it's another class, they're trying to get an A in the class. This is a totally ineffective approach. The spiritual path is something like, let's say you're underwater and you've dove down deep in the water and you're trying to get to the surface and you're running out of oxygen. And you just feel like, wow, I've got to get to the surface fast. I just got to get there. And then you get there, it's, oh, wow, that's great. Well, the spiritual path is kind of like this feeling like you desperately need oxygen. And so this like you feel like I just have to get the answer. Have to get the answer. It's got nothing to do with trying to please a teacher, get an A on a test or whatever. It's just getting the answer. Getting free of this fear, this misery, this fear. So it's very intense. And it's something that is all important to your life. It is the number one, all important, nothing else even comes close. This is the spiritual path. You get up in the morning, you realize, I've got a severe problem. My continuity problem is still with me. This is horrible. And I'm gonna die this way. This is terrible. I can't fail. I must not fail. And so I know people get up every day and they jog every single day. They've been doing it for 30 years or more. Okay? So people have discipline. The spiritual path is discipline. You get up every day and you say, today I will find the answer today, or at least collapse trying, basically. Or, you know, if I don't find it, it will not be as a result of not trying. Giving my very best. And you just simply have to keep working at it and working at it and working at it, no matter what your past karma coming up, the habits that you had in the past, they will certainly come up as an expression of a continuity fear to block you, to distract you. You have to say, okay, it doesn't matter. Whatever comes up, I'm going to keep on keeping on. Keep on trying my very best. It's no different for me, no different for anybody. It's a lifetime commitment. It's a lifetime commitment. But again, a life without spiritual intensity is no life at all. It's a desperate attempt to compensate. Doesn't work. Doesn't work. People get down their life and just say, wow, what did I do? Just no. But if you really have gotten into the spiritual intensity, it will turn out differently for you, for sure. For instance, early this morning, as I woke up, I'm still having problems sleeping. It's under so much stress. I had this amazing experience. It's amazing. How do we explain the subtlety of letting go of what isn't even there? You know, because as Ramana Maharshi says, we have all these spiritual practices designed to remove what isn't even there. So it's true. It's very funny, but so they have these experiences, these subtle experiences in dreaming. It's very difficult to explain, but I had this pop, 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 sort of like these blocks were like just boom, opening up, boom, 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 boom. Each one was death. Each one was this death block. And I just sitting there, I was just like, wow, look, experiencing this popping of death, popping of death, popping of death, popping of death. Very much had to do with death and dissolving, you know, of death. I say, okay, this is very interesting. Yeah, so, and then in the morning, I ask the Holy Spirit, and keep in mind, very important, that the inner teacher is the true teacher. You can call it what you want, but it's the inner teacher. I call it the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit knows everything. It's in charge of the path. It's in charge of your salvation, actually. And so the external teacher is helpful in various ways, but the real root teacher is the inner teacher, and that's the one that you must rely upon on your path, as I have done. Ask your inner teacher what to do. Can you suggest an exercise? Can you suggest a practice? Can you suggest some way to go forward? And just keep at listening and responding, and you get what you need right where you're at. So the way to go forward is rely on the inner teacher. Sometimes the inner teacher will introduce you to some external teacher, say, look at this, okay, that's fine. But the inner teacher is the true teacher that's in charge of your path that will bring you all the way through. So the inner teacher asks, oh, well, what do you suggest this morning? Wow. And then it suggested, try this. I have never existed. I have never existed. I said, I have never been. I have never been. I have never existed. I don't exist. I do not exist. I never will exist. I've never existed. I don't know anything. I don't know where I am. I don't know what I am. I don't exist. I've never existed. So I started using this, and it was fantastic. I loved it, absolutely loved it. I said, this is the best practice I've ever had. Now, this is a far cry from, you know, phase one, two, and three, where you cannot say these types of statements and relate to them in a super positive way, as I'm able to now in phase four. I said, this is great. This is exactly what I want to hear. I don't exist. That is wonderful. And I have an overall positive outlook on what this means, you see, and it's, you can't dissect it very easily, but so phase four, you're able to say, I don't exist. I've never existed. I have never existed. I have never accomplished anything. I don't have any accomplishments whatsoever. I'm perfectly accomplishment free, as is all. There are no accomplishments whatsoever. There is no existence whatsoever. No one has ever existed. No one exists now, and no one has ever existed. Okay, this, it's just saying, this is tremendous. And I felt felt this tremendous optimism and spiritual vibe from this. As I realized, hey, this is very advanced to be able to say this and relate to it in a 100% positive one way, saying, oh, this is exactly what I want to hear and say. And it didn't scare me at all. See, the I, what is the I? The I is our belief in accomplishment. What is a belief in accomplishment? The belief we can change what we are, which is what existence is, an attempt spirit trying to change what it is. And of course, we're perfect, so we try to change that. We have to believe in imperfection. So the I is just this belief that there's something being accomplished. And I say, no, I don't exist. I mean, I don't have any accomplishments. I've never accomplished any change in reality whatsoever. Therefore, this I doesn't exist. What claim can the I have to exist? It doesn't. I've never existed. I've never been born. I've never been born. I've never died. I've never existed. And this really begins to move one into a, move one's comfort zone towards isness. Yeah. This is a really, really heavy phase four practice. And the Holy Spirit just suggested it to me because I was ready for it. Now, if you look into a book and try to read a book and it tells you this practice, you say, okay, I need to practice it. That's not the way, because you have to ask your inner teacher what your practice is, because everybody's at a different spot. Just happened today, I was ready for this practice because of yesterday and the day before, etc. The momentum, yesterday, feeling the stillness of God and how no accomplishment is needed whatsoever. We don't need to do anything. We cannot change it, and I just have, so I have this really good vibe going, and I'm able to do this practice and benefit from it tremendously. So don't try to parrot anybody. Just get encouragement, reassurance, encouragement. But you have to ask the inner teacher, who knows your situation perfectly, what you need to do this today. But try, and every morning ask the Holy Spirit and say, what do I need to do today? And then work on it during the day. Yeah, I worked on this during the day. Not fantastically, because but I did certainly do a lot of work on it, and still am by doing this video. And I'm ready for the next step, I feel like, yeah. So I feel in a good situation by being able to say this. There's certain keys that Jesus points out. If you're able to say this and feel very positive, like attracted to this, this is great. He says that is the key. That's a real key, and you're saving yourself immeasurable delay by doing so. And you're right on the threshold. You're right there on the threshold to just, you know, walk through into isness. Accepting. So I have to take it like this. This is a positive, very positive situation going on. Even though the external karma is not good at all. So again, don't make any excuses. No matter how bad your outer situation is, continue to ask the Holy Spirit, what would you like me to practice today, Holy Spirit? Doesn't matter if the whole universe is collapsing. You say, what would you like me to practice today, Holy Spirit, or this moment? And whatever it says, just do it. Just do it. The Holy Spirit knows best. It knows every detail of every situation, the entirety of it, all the way to the end. It knows it all right now. So whatever it says for you is going to be the most helpful for you, even though intellectually you won't be able to understand, probably. It's our situation is too intricately complicated and delusional to be able to understand, you know, why is this exactly more helpful than something else. But the Holy Spirit does know. Holy Spirit does know. So that's a very, very important advice. No matter what is happening in your life, keep your faith in the Holy Spirit and ask, what do I need to be practicing right now? What would you have my attention focus on? Like that. And don't worry about outcomes. Just work at it. Just work at it. The outcomes will, the next day, it'll be something else to be focused on. Jesus does say, try before you do any practice to remind yourself, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. He says this sets the tone, okay? So that's the basic tone for the intensity. Not a body, I am free, I am as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am spirit. I am still spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. And then I say the continuity fear. The only problem I have is the continuity fear. I do not have a, and then name any problem. I do not have a confusion problem. I have a continuity problem. I do not have a confusion problem. I have a continuity problem. So whatever is bugging you, grab a hold of it and say, hey, I do not have this problem. Be very assertive. I do not have a concentration problem. I have a continuity problem. Concentration problem doesn't exist, has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Because only oneness is here. There isn't anything blocking it at all. It's only our belief that we've succeeded in blocking it. It's just a belief. It hasn't been blocked. We've not separated ourselves. We have a belief that we have, but it's not true. It hasn't happened. But because of the continuity fear, we keep believing that it has happened. So that's why you have all these spiritual practices designed to remove this blockage, which hasn't actually even happened. So it really reinforces, as Ramana says, it reinforces delusion. So you have to be, but you will do that. We go through phases, and you get the fourth phase, and you start realizing, hey, I don't exist. I've never existed. And we say this and just see how you feel about it and full stop in the now. I've never existed. I've never even been. I've never been. I have never been. I've never existed. And what this does is it wakes us up to the now. incredibly beautiful day in California. Frighteningly beautiful, as everything is all the way. Okay, so a little while ago, I started out with, I don't know anything. I don't know. This is Jesus saying it's very important for the leap of faith into I don't know. IDK, laughers, leap of faithers. I don't know, leap of faith into I don't know. All right, then I don't know where. I don't know what. I don't know anything. I don't know anything. And now, it's, I don't exist. I've never existed. I do not exist. So for most people, you think saying, I do not exist, they'd say, oh my gosh, get the white coats out, you know. But here, it's totally understood in the context of what we're doing here, is to realize, I've never existed. There's never been any change in reality. You can't speak of reality as an I. There's never been, it's only one. There's one total oneness. There's never been any change in reality. So I has never existed. I have never existed. And this does bring about a staggering of the mind. Absolutely. I have never existed. I have never existed. But it is very possible, if you put in the work, to get to a point where you can say, I have never existed, and it doesn't bother you at all, really. There's of course, the structure, belief system is shaking, but it's a very positive feeling. It's like, wow, this is great. Now this is getting somewhere. This is really closing in on truth. Continuity fear has been evaporated to a very significant extent, if one can say, I have never existed. I have never existed. I don't exist, and I've never existed. And for me, it's just like, that's the best, sweetest sound I've ever heard. That is fantastic. It's exactly what I want to hear. Now, I said in the previous video that there should be some very effective key for us to bring about the vision of oneness. Now you said the problem is we're afraid to put our attention on it. Well, lo and behold, today it says, I have never existed. I have never existed. And said, oh yeah, that's it. But who's going to say that? I don't exist. I do not exist. Who's going to say that and say, oh, this is the door through to leap of faith into exactly what we really want, which is the vision of oneness. Who's going to have that attitude toward it? So it is here. One can do this. And I realize this is a door, so to speak, a way to really move into vision of oneness. I don't exist. I've never existed. Now, as far as function today, I was driving all over the place, dealing with people and heavy loads and just doing all sorts of stuff. I actually had some work today, and didn't affect me at all in socializing, talking with people. And when I was finished, I just went right back to say, I don't exist. I do not exist. I was driving, was fine. Everything's fine. No problem with functionality. And in fact, I was talking to a bunch of people, and I feel very upbeat, positive, and they respond to that, and they like wanted to talk with me, and they enjoyed, you see. So I don't exist. That's wonderful. I've never existed. Even better. I never will exist. Fantastic. And again, back to this day, it's just a ridiculously nice day. But, you know, so what can we do except keep practicing on such a nice day? But it sort of makes me want to succeed, you know. I do not exist. This is wonderful. What a great day to not exist. So I've always said that late October, early November have always been the time when I really make great progress, and it's the same this year. Same. Interesting. I don't know why. But this removing of these death blocks was very unexpected, and I don't know what to say about it. And remember, the spiritual path is not an academic situation at all. It's totally intense. It totally absorbs your attention, your efforts. And there's no other right use of time at all other than the spiritual path, really. It's everyone's responsibility. A life lived without the intensity of the path is a life wasted, no matter what one does. You just see all these people with tons of money, they got all these neuroses. They're not happy. Now, that's not saying that one should not have any money, because the ego does this funny thing, say, I don't exist. It's trying to compensate, trying to take hold of your spiritual path and saying, don't worry, I'll make you really poor, like a destitute bum, and then everybody think you don't exist, and that should make you happy. No, that's a backwards way that the ego always does things in the wrong way. If I've never existed, why do I need to put on an act like I'm trying to get rid of existence? See, that's ridiculous. That's like using all these spiritual paths and efforts to get rid of these blocks that actually are not even there. So, just whatever circumstances you're in, that's fine. Keep practicing. I do not exist. I have never existed. So I cannot tell you what was dissolving, but it had this like cube sort of death or just dissolving. So we'll see what that's all about. And of course, I have never been born. I have never been born. I have never existed. Tell the Holy Spirit, hey, I just like to say this all the time. This is wonderful. Keep it going. Keep it, let's keep this going. This is great. I love it. So keep in mind, those who are on the spiritual path, you're doing the right thing for sure. Absolutely. Even though it's an ordeal, it's a marathon. Do have to remonstrate those who say that don't worry, you can do it in 4 minutes or do a minute or something. Yeah, it's just not right to say that. That is a technique to, for fourth phasers in some way, it can be used that way. But no, we have a continuity fear. Continuity fear isn't removed through some magic. It's we have to move our comfort zone. We have a comfort zone's problem. Continuity problem, continuity comfort zone problem. And moving the comfort zone is a day by day by day by day by day endeavor. The top teachers in history have all unanimously agreed that it's an ordeal. From Buddha to Shankara to Jesus to Ramana Maharshi to Ananda Maima and on in Longjempa. On and on and on and on and on. It's a marathon. It's a marathon. It must move your comfort zone. is more like a career than a schooling, a class. It's, now, A Course in Miracles, the term a course obviously suggests a classroom, taking a class or a course in a class, and then, you know, passing the course in the class. Now, at the time that A Course in Miracles came out, it was necessary to use that term, a course. We were so caught up in academia, in the psychology, the thinking, the way we thought at that time, we felt like, oh, okay, yeah, here's a course. I need to take this course. I read the book, and I read the book, do the lessons, and I graduate. You know, get an A in the class. So, of course, that was 36 years ago, right, for me. Still have not, quote-unquote, graduated. It's way more than a course, you see, but language, the way it has to come in somehow. We have to accept it. It's like a child. We accept the child into our household and help it, you know, and okay, it's like adopting a child. And we think, have expectations of this child, and we think we're going to raise this child up. It's going to go to college. It's going to be bright. This child is going to get a good job. It's going to make us look good. And so we say, okay, yeah. Then gradually we start realizing, wait a minute, this child is different. Well, what's going on here? And this is what happens. I realized that the child I adopted, finally I realized it hasn't learned anything. And then I realized it doesn't need to learn anything. There's nothing to learn. It doesn't exist. It's never existed. Doesn't need to learn anything. Doesn't need to know anything. It is. And it radiates gratitude and happiness in all directions. Fantastically. So, amazingly, by saying I don't exist, I feel great. It's just like, wow. I've always wanted to not exist. Absolutely. Existence is hell. But good news is I don't exist. So this is like great news to hear this. I don't exist. Fantastic. Music to my ears. Or is it just this day is so nice, anything you say, it sounds good. I don't know. But no, I don't exist. I do not exist. For some reason, this seems to bring this great promise and great hope and wonderful news with it, to be able to say that. But again, who is going to be saying that with such a positive acceptance, you know? So when people say, well, God's not helping us, well, this statement could be made by anyone, anytime at all. But just who chooses to do it? Who will actually do it? So God is not trying to block us at all. Just God says, just say I don't exist. I've never existed. Just accept that. I say, oh yeah, that's great. Now, of course, there are those who will take hold of this and claim that their teachers or something and tell the students, okay, just practice, say I don't exist. Something. That's not it. That's not it. Yeah, it's possible to be a pseudo teacher by just, you know, pressuring, throwing these things out. But this understood here, this is all about evaporating the continuity fear. And so I'm only sharing this so that people realize, can see, hey, it is possible. But, you know, it's very doubtful that many are at a place where they can say this positively. But for sure, everyone will get there eventually. So that's why Jesus says, look, I'm telling you, this is going to be very difficult for you to understand and accept. It might sound very fearful to you, but I tell you with this, my utmost love and urgency, that if you can say, I do not know, this is very, very important. Can you at least try to feel this I do not knowness? So he understands, and we all understand, the continuity fear issue is in play. It's in play. So you cannot get it like class or go to a teacher, a teacher says, okay, I know what to tell you, just say, I do not know, and I don't exist. And just say that and you'll be saved. You know, it doesn't work that way. It does not work that way. So just be honest with yourself and feel the continuity fear. Whatever you're practicing, allow yourself to feel and be in touch with yourself and realize, whoa, this is really staggering my mind, what I'm practicing. And say, good, I'm making progress then. I'm making progress. That's why don't take, you know, drugs. Don't practice sober. Okay? Because you have to be in touch with how you feel as far as your mind goes. You have to be able to feel like, wow, this is really staggering my mind. And then full stop in the now, full stop in the burn, full stop in this wow. Have be aware of the wow and say, hey, okay, this is working. Let's be aware of cause and effect here. And build momentum that way. It's not a classroom. It's not an academic issue at all. I stopped paying any attention to academics when I was like 12 years old. Never paid any attention to them since then, really. Plays no role. On the spiritual path, plays no role. Honesty is the best policy on the spiritual path. Be honest about where you're at, what you're feeling, what the continuity fear is doing. And you should not be overwhelmed by the continuity fear. That's why the I don't have a continuity problem. I do have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. But I do not have a blockage problem. Let's put it this way. I do not have a blockage problem. I have a continuity problem. Okay, very important. I do not have a confusion problem. I do not have a blockage problem. I do not have a intensity problem. I do not have an anxiety problem. I have a continuity problem. Insist you only have one problem. And this puts you centered. It centers you and you're in control. And then you're able to do spiritual practice and able to recognize how it brings up this burn. All right. And then just full stop in the burn. Let it subside. And then you become aware that you're in control. You have the ability to do this. You don't have to be overwhelmed. Anything tries to overwhelm me, I say, I do not have this problem. I do not have a distraction problem. I have a continuity problem. I do not have any distraction problem whatsoever. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. The distraction problem absolutely does not exist in the slightest bit. Therefore, has zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. So when you feel overwhelmed and you can't practice, do this continuity practice, and that'll center you, and then you're able to do a practice and feel, you know how you feel, and say, okay, I'm aware. Brings awareness. Now maybe this day feels so great because I feel good somehow. That's possible too, isn't it? Yeah. I don't know. I feel hopeful. I finally have a little bit of hope, it seems like, here. A little more hope than normal. I don't insist. This is tremendous. This is wonderful. And so when we have a moment of realizing, oh, my self is gone missing. I don't know. To say, great, I don't exist. I've never existed. I don't need to change what I am. Everything's fine. So when we look at the situation, this phase four, and compare it to other times and places, etc., we're doing just as good as work as anyone's ever done. It's in the modern context of what we're doing here. It's different than the past. That's fine. It doesn't matter. What we're doing is getting to the to real success, actually. Non-dual abidance, abiding in what is. Different times, different places, different cultures, etc., traditions, all this, well, cycles, whatever. There's all these sorts of uniqueness and stylistic differences, but we don't have to ape any sort of approach in the past. This is working. When one can get. This just happens to be the path that Jesus is laying out for us in modern times. So that's great. I agreed to take this path. And so that's what I've done. We don't have to put new wine into old wineskin. We don't have to integrate this into some, fourth century Buddhist tradition, or even a fourth century Christian tradition, or any other tradition. We don't have to fit it in that way. They wore different clothes back then, different styles, everything. Let it be. They had what they had. We have what we have now. And of course, we were them back then, right? And of course, we were never there in the first place because we don't exist. We've never existed. But whatever was there, whatever, let it be, fine. And we have this here now, fine. Like that. Don't need to compare. Don't need to mix and match at all. We only need to succeed. So I don't exist. I've never existed. I have never existed. And just see how that feels. And for me, my spirit says, well, I like this. I'd like to say this. Yeah, you mean, hey, this is great. I'm waking up. This is what I want to know. Yeah, I've never existed. And I want to know. I've never known anything. I don't know at all. I don't know. How can freedom say that it knows anything? Now, whatever it wants is, it doesn't know anything. It doesn't know any determinism, doesn't know any process, doesn't know any awareness. There's no awareness to spirit, because whatever spirit wants to experience is right here, right now. So there's no issue of awareness. It doesn't say, well, I need to travel here, over there, for this experience. There is no over there. So if there's no over there, there's no here either. Neither here nor over there. Simply the isness, as Jesus says, is beyond here-ness, beyond everywhere-ness. It's the isness. There's no structure of space per se that is necessary to experience. It's always spontaneous. In the now, the isness. So all potential experiences are always right here, right now. There's no need for a concept of space. There's no need for a concept of space. There's no need for a concept of time. There's no need for a concept of process. There's no need for a concept of form at all for reality. None whatsoever. I'm sort of having faint tinges of feeling like I used to feel when younger. It seems to have starting to feel some of those tinges. Prior to really crystallizing time, space, process, and form concepts. And that notion of accomplishment. So the dream I had about this lumberyard starting to burn down, the lumberyard symbolizes all these concepts of accomplishments. Accomplishments, all these accomplishments in time, space. It's impossible for a spirit to accomplish anything. Pure potential is always available for any experience whatsoever. There's no issue of accomplishment at all. So I should let it all burn down. I should just let it all burn and enjoy it. And we'll see if that happens. So you can see the hard work pays off. All this effort has enabled me to get to this point. Absolutely. Familiarity. All this tough, oh, difficult effort. Pay off for you also. Absolutely, it pays off. You don't realize it when you're doing it. You just have to have some faith. But every day you realize, wow, I feel a little more comfortable. Moving one's comfort zone. Move one's comfort zone. Bit by bit, move the comfort zone. The answer, Punjaji, was last words, or where's Buddha? His deathbed words, or where is Buddha? Well, the answer is, of course, Buddha doesn't exist. Buddha's never existed. See? Buddha is. Buddha mind, Buddha refers to isness. Doesn't refer to an I-ness. It refers to isness. Where is Christ? Same thing. Christ refers to isness. Isness has never existed. I don't exist. So, I don't. What comes next? Don't know anything. I simply don't know. I don't know at all. I don't know any accomplishments. I don't know any accomplishments. I'm totally unaware of any accomplishments. I don't know where I am at all. And I don't know what I am at all. And I don't exist. And I've never existed. So I cannot fathom what's going to be the next, really. It just, it's not necessary, just full stop in the now. What can be the next step for what doesn't exist? What can be the next step for what's never existed? So maybe there is no next step. Maybe there's never been any step at all. The next step is no step. If we could just bottle this air right now, how it feels here, that we could sell that to everybody in the world right now. It's just an incredibly mixture of slight coolness, slight warmth, slight moisture in the air, slight crispness. It's just like you can like drink it in almost. It's amazing. The air feels peaceful, very peaceful. So no collapse, no implosion, no white coats necessary, no drugs necessary, no trouble. So this is the fourth phase. So you don't want some first phaser trying to force the issue with drugs or something, some way, you know, that's not it. So patience, perseverance. Sobriety on the path is essential. That's why there are virtues that are super important in society. Super, super important. I've said a life without the spiritual intensity of the spiritual path is a wasted life entirely. And to be on, in order to take the spiritual path, one has to be very sober. Very sober. Okay. So, therefore, there are virtues, patience, perseverance, discipline, determination, sobriety, calmness, centeredness, kindness, compassion, forgiveness, peacefulness, contemplativeness, meditativeness, quietness. So all these virtues that should have to be taught, if we have to be brought up this way, it's very important, or make a great determined effort to gain these virtues and insist upon in our lives. So, if, again, put two and two together, as far as values go, social values, is very easy. A life lived without the intensity of a spiritual path is a life, wasted life, no matter what compensations they want to do. And, of course, we know all the compensations that people are frantically doing all the time. It doesn't work. So, spiritual path requires sobriety, for sure. So, how do we look at culture? What do we emphasize? Sobriety in culture. Absolutely. Absolutely. Some religions ban alcohol, for instance. They ban drugs. They ban alcohol. So, see, sobriety is very important. Some cultures, you know, ban, for instance, meat. They're vegetarians. No, they don't drink alcohol. They don't use drugs. See, that's a wise culture. Try to be calm. They try to be kind to one another. Calm, calmness, kindness. Don't call names. Don't get in arguments. Remain sober. Sober and serious. Sit quietly. Must have prayer time, meditation time every day. Significant time. A lot of cultures have a prayer room in their house. Every house has a prayer room. You go in there and you spend not just 10 minutes, 2 hours. It's not some secret thing like, oh, they're doing something secret. Here it has to be a secret here in this culture. And people think you're crazy. What are you doing? They'll interfere with you. Distract you. It's a culture of distraction we live in right now, an unsober culture of distraction. The less distraction, the better. That's why smartphones are so dumb, actually. I mean, rarely do you see a person who owns a smartphone not be constantly interacting with it, you know, constantly, just all the time. Right? It's just, I just observe. I say, look what it does. And so for me, I say, no way. It's an obvious distraction device. You want to be distracted as little as possible so you can continue your practice during the day. I don't insist. I do not exist. Less distractions, the better. Without making your life too difficult. You don't want to isolate yourself too much. It might become a problem, you know, but just, for instance, I got home today, immediately start taping. There's a time here before dinner, a couple hours. Just do it. Now the phone has rung a couple times. It was a sort of emergency. It was fine. Took care of it. Boom. Okay. That's it. Let a phone be a phone. Don't be distracted. Don't let it be a distraction device. Don't hook yourself into distraction. Stay away from it as much as possible. Not a little bit. But try to minimize it. Don't be fanatical about the path. There's the middle ground path is the way. Don't be fanatical. I've tried, you know, tried various ways now. You just have to be patient and don't tell people, I want to meditate, don't you dare interrupt me. And, you know, you start getting fanatical about it and then you cause yourself a lot of problems. So just be very meek and unassuming and humble about in your life. Meek, humble, unassuming, unpretentious, unboastful. It's very important. Nobody should have any idea that you're, you know, on the third phase or fourth phase or whatever. Nobody, you should not, you know, brag about it. As far as your, you know, social world goes, you don't go wear a shirt saying, I'm a great meditator or something. you try to play it low-key. Just do it. I do not exist. Just do it. I do not exist. In fact, there isn't any existence. There's no existence whatsoever. That widens it out quite a bit. Dismiss any thoughts that arise. Just say, no, I'm full stopped here. I'm not entertaining any dialogue, discussion, thoughts, considerations, storylines. I do not exist. Nothing exists. There is no existence. Meek, humble, unassuming, low-key. Those are the ones that succeed. Those are the ones that succeed. It's a very gradual thing, the path, very gradual, until you reach phase four, and then everything flips, and you realize, I don't exist. I've never existed. Therefore, I've never existed. There's no step I can take. There's no step at all. See, the thing that we're worried about, continuity fear, is we want to imagine there's all these steps back to what we are, and ultimately realize there's no steps at all. We've never left. That's the final, like, staggering of the mind. Whoa, no steps. Now, where's the step? I don't see any step. I don't even see anyone to take a step. There's no one that can take a step. There's no step, no one to take a step. And it's like, okay. No step, no one to take a step. That's what we're headed towards. A little struggle comes up there. There's others. Just don't focus on this, on the struggle. Turn your attention off of it. Don't entertain struggle. Don't struggle with the struggle. Turn your attention off of it. Struggle is being suggested. And just don't pick up on the suggestion. Wow. Be nice if this atmosphere just continued forever. This would be like, wow, it's very nice. Good grief. That's why everyone's in California, but there's no water here. That's the only problem. We don't know what this winter will be like. But unless it's some really heavy, heavy rainy winter, the problem will very much continue. Big trouble. There's big trouble everywhere, isn't there? But good thing, nothing exists. There is no existence. Good thing I don't exist. Right? Good thing I've never existed, actually. Never existed. Very good news. Very good news. I've never existed. That means I don't, certainly not required to have any accomplishments, right? Certainly can't expect to have any accomplishments then if I've never existed. That's right. So I don't need any accomplishments. I don't need to do anything. Don't need anything. Can be empty-handed, absolutely. These connections will be made, they're being made just organically, inherently. One doesn't have to force it. It's better to stay with the burn. Just keep on repeating and keep this burn going, full stop in the burn. Don't worry how it all is working positively. It is. Just noticing like, wow, I can see that's going to be very positive soon. Okay, great. But don't try to determine the future from now. Stay in the now. Yeah. November can be a very nice month. October, November. This November so far has just been a beauty. Very hot in the bay. We had fog that was so dense you couldn't hardly see 20 feet in front of you. It's just super dense. In other areas it was crystal clear. Existence is like that heavy fog. Crystal clarity is like I don't exist. I got close to the fog, drove close to it, and I saw, wow, it lingered all day. It's like really right on the ground, this heavy stuff. And then it went up high into the mountains, and it was just absolutely crystal clear, overlooking the Pacific Ocean. Just like beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Wow. See, I don't exist. I was driving through the mountains. I don't exist. I've never existed. As I'm here, I'm driving through these beautiful mountains, you know, and fall. I don't exist. I've never existed. Everything looked like a charm. It's like, oh. That's great. So this is like the dawning of greatness. I've never existed. So when this can be greeted with exaltation, then it should be the dawn should be coming, right? What's to stop the dawn? What's to stop the dawn? Which is really our attention. Remember, this globe turns. The sun stays where it is. This globe turns. So our attention is really what's moving. And to see the dawn. We're seeing the dawn because our attention is being moved as we on this planet. So my attention, what's to stop my attention from seeing this dawn? So I can say for sure, people, take the spiritual path, be sober, make sure, work, if you're not sober, work towards sobriety, absolutely work towards sobriety, in every way. Work towards modesty in every way. Work towards meekness in every way, meekness, modesty, sobriety. Be humble, meek and humble, unassuming. Sit quietly and have your mind be staggered by the good news. And what better news is that than to realize that I have never existed? It's like a jewel. It's like a beautiful jewel. Seeing that is like, wow. What a beautiful jewel that is. It's a jewel-like day today around the bay. Jewel-like day. Jewel-like evening right now. Wow. Jewel-like contemplation. I've never existed. I have never, ever existed. I don't exist. I've never existed. Is happening. So that's very nice, but I've never existed. Nothing has ever existed. Existence has never been. Plane flies by, fine, but I don't exist. I do not exist. I don't exist. So we will see how this unfolds. But however it unfolds, I don't exist. So maybe there's no unfoldment, there's no step, there's no unfoldment, because there's no existence. So I don't exist, I-D-E, and die, to die, D-I-E. I don't exist. And die might be, do I exist? The question, do I exist? Trying to answer the question, do I exist? And to get free of, do I exist? We say, I do not exist. I do not exist. So to get free of dying, say, I do not exist. I-D-K. I don't know. I don't exist. I-D-E. I don't, I-D-E, I don't exist. That flips the script of, do I exist? Or don't I exist? Saying, hey, don't I exist? Do I exist? I don't exist. I've never existed. That takes the D-I-E into I-D-E. Gone is the D-I-E. Gone is the dying. Do I exist? Do I existing? Do I exist? Question mark? Ing? Dying? Are we dying? No, I don't exist. I've never existed. I don't exist. So where's the dying? There's no dying. I don't exist. How can what doesn't exist die? I've never existed. I've never had any accomplishment whatsoever. There are no accomplishments. So, this is just a normal day, right? Working, eating, sleeping, and also realizing I don't exist. This is how it always is. This is how it always is. As Ramana says, we're trying to do is remove a problem that doesn't exist. I looked at Ramana's eyes last night and I said, wow, I could see the peace beyond the body, so to speak. But I realized we're looking at it wrongly, at least I am. It's like, it's not the body that's at peace. The body's like a mask. The peace is behind the mask. The body's not producing, the body's eyes are not producing the peace. Ramana's not a body at peace. Ramana doesn't exist. Ramana has never existed. It's like there's this ocean of peace just there. There's this ocean there. It's not Ramana there, it's the ocean of peace is there. There just happens to be a body so people can have a focal point of considering this. There's no existence at all there. And yet the body talks and smiles and walks and day without spiritual intensity is a wasted day. A life without spiritual intensity is a wasted life. So get with it. And if others don't want to, don't follow their trend. If they want to be unsober, don't follow that trend. They're wasting their lives. Because remember, we're spirit. And spirit doesn't exist, right? Spirit doesn't exist at all. Spirit has never existed. Spirit is. So what really makes us feel alive is to recognize we don't exist. If you want to feel alive, realize and accept that you don't exist. I've never existed. Or get comfortable with it, as we're doing. Had a kamikaze driver go past me again today. Seems like every day. Black Mercedes. Everybody's doing the speed limit or a little above. Pretty heavy traffic. Suddenly something like sort of startles me, and this car just goes screaming past me on the freeway. Cuts in front of me, weaves around someone else, cuts his way this, just weaving their way through traffic, going maybe 110 miles an hour. Yeah, over 100 for sure. Who knows how fast they're just and they're almost gone. It's going so fast. Everybody else is going fast on the freeway. It's a kamikaze driver. It's just scary. You just say, holy cow. They're on the edge there. So, you know, maybe it's a sign of the world, isn't it? But I just said, hey, that's cool. I don't exist. I've never existed. Just kept the practice going. Someone is not having any spiritual intensity in their life, so they have to drive 110 miles an hour weaving through traffic. It doesn't work. Someone is not being sober. It doesn't work. And don't worry about the times when you weren't sober. Every time, eventually everyone has to sober up, so you just sober up. That's it. Let it go. It's unproductive. Didn't get you what you want, so now you're not being productive in your life. A productive life is a spiritual life that's productive. Everything else is unproductive, actually, because what a productive life is to realize I've never existed. I don't exist, and I've never existed. That's a productive life. Everything else is just folly. Everything else is just dying. Asking, do I exist? Do I exist? Do I exist? Do I exist? Just dying. Everything else is just dying. We're saying, I don't exist. That's productive life. See, we're flipping the script here. We're flipping the script. So let your script be flipped. And that's it for this one.